Welcome back to the Find Your Purpose Now podcast. I'm so glad you're here. I thought today we should talk about how purpose, living our purpose, is real, true success. I hear a lot of people talking about success and posting on social media about their perceived success. And, you know, I can't help but wonder how many of those people who are the kind of self-proclaimed experts on success and how to get success and, you know, who post about their outrageously successful life, I wonder if they really are. I wonder if they're experiencing real, authentic, true success. Because I don't know. I mean, a lot of the stuff that I've seen people post, and some of these people I know personally, and I know about personal circumstances, and I think, wow, the social media posts don't even remotely resemble what their real life is like. But the picture that they paint for people is that they have this amazing, perfect life. And it makes me sad, actually, because I think, well, first of all, deceit is just never a good idea. And painting a picture of a life that really does not exist is just sad to me. Like, do you think that your actual life is so bad that you can't really tell the truth about it? Or that you're not good enough or less than in some way that you have to make yourself appear to be something that you're not? Or make your life appear in a way that is not an accurate reflection of your real life? And that's, you know, that's not to say that we all should be posting on social media about, you know, every hard thing that we have. I mean, nobody wants to know if I slam my finger in the door of the car. So there, you know, we don't have to post about every awful thing, but we also, I think, need to take a look at the lives of, you know, the real lives of people to know whether or not we really want to follow their advice. Is it worth following? You know, because if the pictures of the amazing cars are of cars that are leased, okay, they're not owned, they're leased. As long as you make the payment, then you get to keep the car. The first time you don't make the payment, they come get the car. You don't own the car. The amazing private jet, really? Come on. You know, so a lot of people appear to be living a life that really is, I mean, all it is just debt. It's facade. And the minute the payments stop, that stuff goes away. And it might not even be their payment to make. You know, the times I've flown on private planes, the planes weren't mine. So I'll just say it. I wouldn't make those payments and take care of that, all of that maintenance and be responsible for all that. No, thank you. So look at the lives of the people that you're following and decide whether or not you really want to follow them. So let's talk a little bit about what real success is, what it really is, so that when you see it, you'll know it. Real success is accompanied by a sense of peace and contentedness that comes from the fulfillment of living the life you were born to live, doing the things that you were created to do, things that are fairly easy for you to do. Not to say that there's not hard work involved, but it's not brutal. It's not torture. You know, when you really have true success, you really enjoy what you're doing. Some people actually love what they do. That was me. yeah, it was a lot of work, but I thrived on it. I loved it. It made me feel alive and it made me feel worthwhile and valuable. I think a lot of our self-esteem comes from that feeling of doing something that we know that we're good at, that somebody else needs done. And it just makes us feel good to do it. There's a sense of accomplishment and contentedness, satisfaction and fulfillment that come along with doing what you were made to do. That's real success. And then good relationships come along with that, because when you're in that flow state where you're doing what you were made to do, you're loving it, you have a good attitude, and you're happier. And that happiness is contagious. Those attitudes, those good attitudes are contagious and they're attractive. When we're happy and we're smiling and we're feeling good about ourselves because we feel fulfilled, we attract other people to ourselves. And I'm not talking about New Age hocus pocus. It's just a fact. When we walk around miserable and critical and irritable and grouchy and criticizing everything that everybody does, well, hello, no, that's not attractive. That's not going to attract people to us and invite people to come into our lives and be close to us. And it's certainly not going to influence them in any kind of positive way. So when we're doing what we're made to do, oh, the good relationships that come out of that, long-term, solid relationships with good people, loyal people who really care about you, and you really care about them, those relationships enrich our lives in ways that is hard to explain if you don't get it. But when you find yourself in one of those relationships, you know it and you value it, particularly if you haven't had relationships like that before. I mean, if you're somebody like me who came from a dysfunctional, abusive family, when you start to have relationships that are real and authentic and nurturing, caring, loving, it's an epiphany, because you haven't seen that before. It's amazing. And for those of us who have come from hard places, we value those relationships, I think, more than the average person, because they're life-changing for us. They give us hope that there's good in the world, that there's a better future for us. So not only do you have that feeling of accomplishment from doing what you do well, but in those personal relationships where, you know, it's the kind of person who you could call at 2 o'clock in the morning and say, I'm in pain, or, you know, I'm going through a hard time. Can you help me? And they are there for you. I mean, that's personal success. When you can be in those kinds of relationships where you're there for somebody and they're there for you. I spent years and years and years and years reading books, success books, business books, motivational books, sales books, self-help books, psychology, social work, you name it. Hundreds, hundreds, hundreds of books. I read at least a book a week for most of my life. And during the years that I was trying to figure out how to make it, I read a lot of things, classic success books, Zig Ziglar, Napoleon Hill, Ryan Tracy, Dr. Dennis Waitley, Jim Rohn. Gosh, I could go on and on. And I wish that all the success tips that I learned through those years, I wish that somebody would have told me those things. I wish that there would have been one book that had all of those things in it. And so I couldn't find it. I never did find it. So I wrote it. And that's kind of the story of all the books that I've written. Every one of the, I think we're on 15 now, every one of the books that I've written, blog articles that I've written, magazine articles, podcasts, it's always about a need that I see or something that I needed when I was younger and just starting out in life and in work and business that didn't exist. So I wrote a little ebook called Success Tips on the Basics and in Life. And it's just bullet points. It's broken down into different sections and whatnot, so it could sort of be a reference book. It's a workbook. There's a place to make your own notes about what works for you, or taking one of the success tips and kind of tweaking it and making it work in your life, in your industry that you're in, or wherever you want to be. The idea, though, is this book is free. You can go to my website and get it, Rhonda, rhonda.org, and use the coupon code free now. No spaces, just free now. All one word. And put it to work. Use those success tips to create your own personal and professional success. And if you want to go a little bit deeper, get a copy of my book, Succeed Because of What You've Been Through, because that book is all about mining the lessons out of the most painful times of our lives. Because I'm telling you, it's in those times of our lives that we learn the most profound lessons. And when you take those things, those lessons, and you apply those things to your future, you're literally creating your successful life. And I'll tell you, this is important because most of us think we want happiness. And it is important. I mean, obviously, we want to be happy. Everybody wants to be happy. I wrote a book, 30 Days to Happiness. I think it's important to be happy. But it's not the only thing. And if happiness and reaching our happiness, having happiness, holding on to happiness, if that's our ultimate goal, then it is inevitable that we're going to feel like we're failing and we're going to feel like we're losing, because something will always come along to steal that feeling of happiness, because that's life. And we're in a broken world and there are knuckleheads everywhere. I mean, one of the books I wrote, I wanted the title to be How to Be Kind to Jerks, Jokers, and Jackasses, because it seems like everywhere you go, they're there. And so there's always going to be something that steals our happiness. On the other hand, if we live to fulfill our purpose and to enjoy our real success, that's a different thing. Because when hard things happen, when painful things happen, you don't feel like you're failing. You don't feel like you're losing. You feel like you have an opportunity to mine the lessons out of the challenges in front of you. I'm going to unpack that just a little bit. Because I remember reading that when I was 19, 20, 21. I think it was W. Clement Stone or Earl Nightingale, maybe both, who talked about looking at problems as challenges and opportunities. And I remember thinking, oh my, really? Well, this person's never had a hard day. I mean, this was a time in my life where I was barely had food on the table. I was barely making it. But what I learned was they were right. Every problem, every challenge, every frustration, every frustrating person represents an opportunity for us to grow in our maturity, grow in our understanding of life, of people, of circumstances, situations. And the more we can learn, the more qualified and equipped we are to create our successful lives. At the end of the day, it's up to us to do that, right? If we are waiting for a knight in shining armor to ride up on a white horse and sweep us off of our feet and take care of everything and make us happy, we're going to wait a long time. It just doesn't work that way. It doesn't exist. Those are old Hollywood movies. And when we cede the responsibility for our own happiness to another person, we're giving that other person way too much control over our lives. Don't give your happiness or control of it over to somebody else, the same as you wouldn't give your freedom over to somebody else and let them lock you in a cage and walk away with the key. That's what this is like. Don't put the responsibility for your happiness on anyone else. It's too much responsibility for anybody else. And there are people out there who will try because they love you and they care about you and they will try to make you happy, and it's temporary. Just like a new car. Makes us happy. Everything's awesome. It smells great. It's perfect. It's clean. And you know what? 3 months later, when it doesn't smell good anymore and it's not all that clean and you're making the payments and the insurance premium is higher than you thought it was going to be, it's just not making you happy anymore. That kind of happiness is fleeting. So you see, hopefully you see my point, hopefully I'm making sense, that if we make our whole lives about pursuing happiness, we're building our house on the sand. If we make our lives about living our purpose and finding meaning in every frustration and every painful situation, we will achieve real, true, authentic success. And then we will have not just happiness, but what goes along with it is joy. Joy is so much better than happiness because happiness is superficial. It's fleeting. I can be happy at the party and 30 minutes later, I'm not at the party anymore. And I have to face reality and I can be sad. I'm driving along, everything's fine, I'm happy, I'm singing in the car along with the radio, and some knucklehead cuts me off and I'm not happy anymore. Joy, on the other hand, is inside. Joy is not switched off or unplugged or diminished when somebody cuts me off in traffic. Or when we get a bad medical diagnosis, or when something horrible happens to somebody we love. Joy doesn't prevent bad things from happening, but what it does is you carry the joy inside of you and you bring it along with you into the difficult times in life. It's that joy inside of you that helps you see that there's hope. There's hope that you will get through this, you will get on the other side of it. And you can do that with peace. When you're being your most authentic self, living your God-given identity, and flowing in the purpose for which you were perfectly matched, that peace and joy will get you through anything. Happiness will not. It's great when you have it, but it so easily disappears. So, I hope that you'll get a copy of my free success tips ebook, workbook, combo thing. And I hope that you'll subscribe and share this and reach out to me. I'd love to know what you think. I want to know about your real success. I'd love to hear from you. There's a link in the description to send a voice note, or you could go to my website, Rhonda, R-H-O-N-D-A.org, and send me a message there. I hope that this podcast is helpful to you. I have some fun, really fascinating guests coming up. So check back next week and let's do everything we can to influence the people in our lives to be who they were really meant to be and live their purpose. When they see us doing it, it's attractive. Your authentic smile, your joy, your peace, your good relationships, your real good life is the most persuasive and attractive to others. Works better than preaching, works better than lecturing. I've tried all that. Doesn't work out very well. At least it didn't for me. So I hope this is helpful. I'll see you next week.